Thank you. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and thus deserve to be eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you for God's love and mercy, and for the sake of the Holy Angels and the Lord's Church of the Dead, of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious.
Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God and quality. And instead, by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity and the undivided unity. Let us give glory to him because he has shown his mercy to us.
Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and infants, you have established strength.
When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place.
What is man that you are mindful of him, and the Son of Man that you care for him?
Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings, and crowned him with glory and honor.
Thank you.
acknowledge the glory of the eternal Trinity, and by the confession of a true faith, and to worship the unity and the power of the divine majesty, keep us steadfast in his faith, and defend us from all adversities. For you, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, live and reign, one God, now and forever. Isaiah chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up. The train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." And one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is from Romans chapter 11. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways! Or who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him, and through him, and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand for the altar. Jesus answered him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, 'You must be born again.' The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know, and bear witness to what we have seen. You do not receive our testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." This is the gospel of the Lord. We confess our faith according to the Athanasian Creed found on page 397. recovered from medicine. Whoever desires to be saved must, above all,
hold to Catholic faith.
Whoever does not keep his whole undefiled will without doubt perish eternally. And the Catholic faith is this, that we worship one God in Trinity, and Trinity in unity, neither confusing the persons, nor dividing the substance. For the Father is one person, the Son is another, and the Holy Spirit is another. For the Godhead of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit is one, the glory equal, the majesty co-eternal. Such as the Father is, such is the Son, and such is the Holy Spirit. The Father uncreated, the Son uncreated, the Holy Spirit uncreated. The Father infinite, the Son infinite, the Holy Spirit infinite. The Father eternal, the Son eternal, the Holy Spirit eternal. And yet there are not three eternals, but one eternal. Just as there are not three uncreated or three infinites, but one uncreated and one infinite. In the same way, the Father is almighty, the Son is almighty, the Holy Spirit is almighty. And yet there are not three almighties, but one almighty. So the Father is God, the Son is God, the Holy Spirit is God. And yet there are not three gods, but one God. So the Father is Lord, the Son is Lord, the Holy Spirit is Lord. And yet there are not three lords, but one Lord. Just as we are compelled by the Christian truth to acknowledge each distinct person as God and Lord, so also are we prohibited by the Catholic religion to say that there are three gods or lords. The Father is not made, nor created, nor begotten by anyone. The Son is neither made nor created, but begotten of the Father alone. The Holy Spirit is of the Father and of the Son, neither made nor created nor begotten, but proceeding. Thus there is one Father, not three fathers, one Son, not three sons, one Holy Spirit, not three Holy Spirits. And in His Trinity, none is before or after another, none is greater or less than another. But the whole three persons are co-eternal with each other and co-equal, so that in all things, as has been stated above, the Trinity in unity and unity in Trinity is to be worshipped. Therefore, whatever desires to be saved must and must bow to Trinity. But it is also necessary for everlasting salvation that one faithfully believe the incarnation of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is for my faith that we believe and confess that our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is at the same time both God and man. He is God, begotten with the substance of the Father before all ages, and He is man, born from the substance of His mother in this age, perfectly God and perfectly man, composed of rational soul and human flesh, equal to the Father with respect to His divinity, less than the Father with respect to His humanity. Although He is God and man, He is not two, but one Christ. One, however, not by the conversion of divinity into flesh, but by the assumption of the humanity which we have. One altogether, not by the fusion of substance, but by the unity of persons. For as the rational soul and flesh is one man, so God and man is one Christ, who suffered for our salvation, descended into hell, rose again in the third day from the dead, ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, God Almighty, from whence He will come to judge the living and the dead. At His coming, all people will rise again with their bodies and give an account concerning their own deeds. And those who have done good will enter into eternal life, and those who have done evil into eternal fire. This is the path of faith. Whoever does not believe faithfully and firmly cannot be saved.
You may be seated for our hymn of the day, number 904.
You may be seated. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Swedes call it a smorgasbord. We Americans call it a buffet. You know, it's really not a bad idea. You take your plate, walk alongside a table, and put on your plate whatever your heart, perhaps your stomach, desires. There are many delicious dishes to choose from. You can take a little or a lot from a few or from many. You decide what you will eat. Now that may be fine when choosing what we will put into our bodies, but a pick-and-choose cafeteria's theology is a deadly diet for the soul. God doesn't let you pick and choose between a variety of spiritual foods. Rather, he feeds you what he decides you need to eat. He forbids you from eating anything except what he has put on the plate for you. This divine insistence angers foolish, rebellious, and immature people who think they know better than God does about what is best for them. Well, our world today promotes this buffet kind of Christianity that mixes God's revealed truth with the contradictory teachings of other religions. Afraid to confess the one and only saving faith with conviction, nominal Christians pick up a little bit of Hinduism here, a little bit of humanism there, and maybe a dash of homegrown American pull yourself up to God by your bootstraps for seasoning. Eventually, the one holy Christian and apostolic faith becomes compromised to the point that it isn't even Christian anymore. Well, Nicodemus taught God's word. He knew that Jesus was a great teacher, and a greater teacher than he was. Jesus did miracles that no ordinary teacher could do. Who else but a teacher sent from heaven could change water into wine? Claimed divine authority. Nicodemus thought that Jesus might have some very important things to say. He naturally assumed that what Jesus had to say to him would not differ, at least not essentially, from what he already knew. But he was wrong. Nicodemus wanted Jesus to teach him, but he wasn't ready to confess Jesus publicly. So he came to him at night to begin a conversation. He began by paying Jesus a compliment. He said that Jesus was a teacher sent from God and that God was with Jesus. Perhaps he thought that Jesus would return that compliment. Instead, Jesus floored him with his response. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. It is as if Jesus said, Nicodemus, you want to learn from me. You want instruction from God. Good. Now listen to me. You cannot learn a thing until you become a new man. You must have a second birth. This will not be like the birth, your first birth, when you came out of your mother's womb and entered this world a sinner. You were born blind, dead, and in conflict with God. No, you need instead a birth that comes from heaven. You need a spiritual birth. You need to be born of water and spirit. Jesus says that to you and to me. If you want to learn, great. Jesus wants attentive students who are willing to listen to what he has to say. So learn this first. You know nothing until you are born again. Born from above. Born by the power of the Holy Spirit. Born of water and the Spirit. Many people who are baptized return to the flesh from which they were first born and reject the teachings of Jesus. They do not inherit the kingdom of God. They live and they die without God. This does not mean their baptism did nothing for them. If I despise God's gift, I do not thus make it worthy of being despised. A mob of hate-filled and bloodthirsty people who screamed for Jesus' death despised him and held him in contempt. But did Jesus deserve to be despised? Is Jesus worthy of contempt? Is he not the radiance of the Father's glory, the very image of God, the pure, holy, and spotless Son of the Father, full of grace and truth? See him lifted up on the cross. Look, serpent in the wilderness was viewed with respect as those who gathered around, dying of the poisonous venom flowing through their bodies, see their friends and families regain their health simply by looking up at the serpent on the pole. Most of those who gathered around the cross looked up only to mock Jesus, with their words of contempt. It was on the cross that the entire world of sinners was set free from all their sins. On the cross, the anger of God against all humanity came to an end. On the cross, heaven and earth were reconciled. On the cross, the new heavens and the new earth were created. On the cross, the Son of Man was lifted up. And there, being lifted up, he was ridiculed and tortured and hated and mocked. But it is there, where the Son of Man was being lifted up, that the Almighty God was righting every wrong, calming every fear, forgiving every sin, and bringing us all back to him as his restored and holy children. We do not judge by appearances, but by God's word. We live on every word that God says to us. The world does not believe that everyone who believes in the Son of Man lifted up on that cross will not perish but have eternal life. The world does not believe that those who are washed by water and the Holy Spirit and holy baptism are born from above. The world does not believe in that its power, wisdom, and achievements have no value before God. The world trusts in the world. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. It knows nothing else. It sees nothing else. It cannot be taught because it cannot learn. We must be born from above. Now, does this mean that we Christians who believe and are baptized have a perfect understanding? Well, no. But we can, by the grace of God, confess the truth that he reveals. God reveals this truth to us in the words of the Holy Scriptures. God has preserved in his church the pure confession of that truth. We confess the true God. We confess the mystery of the Holy Trinity. We are born again when we are baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. These are not three gods, but one God. Yet the person of the Father is not the person of the Son, or the person of the Holy Spirit. The Father begets the Son. The Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. The Son has always been begotten from his Father. The Holy Spirit has always proceeded from the Father and the Son. These three persons are not three gods, but have always been, and will always be, one God, the only God who has ever existed or will exist. The Holy Trinity is not a theory about God. He is God. The Church did not come up with the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. The triune God has taught that he is triune from the beginning of time. The triune God revealed throughout the Old Testament. From the first words of Genesis, to God's appearance to Abraham in the form of three men, the benediction that God gave to Aaron, that we ourselves still receive at the end of the divine service each Sunday, to Isaiah's vision of God who is thrice holy, and on and on and on. We Christians confess our faith in the words of the Athanasian Creed, which begins, "Whoever desires to be saved must, above all, hold the Catholic faith. Whoever does not keep it whole and undefiled will without doubt perish eternally. And the Catholic faith is this, that we worship one God in Trinity, and Trinity in unity, neither confusing the persons nor dividing the substance." All Christians confess the Holy Trinity. Those who will not confess the Trinity are not Christians. We must say specifically in reference such religious organizations as the Jehovah's Witnesses, the Mormons, the Unitarians, and any other group that denies the Trinity, are not Christian. All Christians confess and teach this doctrine of the Trinity. The creeds weren't written to establish the doctrine of the Trinity, to confess the truth that God has always revealed. The only way we can know the true God to look where the world in its wisdom mocks God. To know the triune God, you must look at Jesus, lifted up on the cross. You want to see the Father's love for you? Look at Jesus lifted up on the cross. There you will see exactly how much your Father in heaven loves you. As St. Paul puts it, "He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things?" The depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments, how inscrutable his ways. You want to see the grace of your Lord Jesus Christ, and know that that grace is intended for you, and it is your sins that are forgiven? Look at Jesus on the cross. For whose sin is he suffering, not for yours? And if he is so suffering, then what has happened to those sins of yours? He paid for them, aren't they washed away by his blood? Aren't you set free from their guilt? What does the Bible say? Whoever believes in him shall not perish. That means you. You want to see the comfort of the Comforter? Know that you belong to God in fellowship with other believers? Look at Jesus uplifted up on the cross. There you see what it is that your baptism provides you. There you see that the God who knows every sinful secret in your heart does not judge you because of that sin. Instead, gives you the full forgiveness of all your sins. This is your comfort. The water that washed your body is the water joined to the blood shed on Calvary. By the authority of Christ, the Holy Spirit gives you everlasting life that no one in this world can take away from you. God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, knows what it is that we need, because we need him. We need his holy word. We don't understand to believe, we believe to understand. We do not pick and choose for ourselves the food for our souls. The one who baptized us into eternal union with himself lays before us a rich feast, a most wonderful food. He reveals to us the great mystery of God. We are born from above. We never hunger or thirst again. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We stand to sing the
away from my presence, let me drown.
Lord of hosts, we worship you not as we ought, but as we are able, within the frailty of our minds and hearts that still struggle against sin and unbelief. Guard us by your Spirit, that we may not grow weary nor lose sight of the goal before us. Work in us to display the good works of him who has called us from darkness into his marvelous light. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of hosts, have mercy on those who would deny the new birth of water and the Spirit to infants and children. Open their eyes and hearts to the fullness of your grace. They would no longer hinder these little ones from being born again and seeing your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of hosts, you've established marriage and sanctified the home to be a place of blessing and love. Give your parent and child the courage to love as you have loved us. Unite them in their common life by your Spirit to know Jesus and serve him. Bless the single with chastity, comfort the widow, protect the orphan, and defend the helpless. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of hosts, we thank you for the many blessings you have bestowed upon this nation. Grant us a long memory to recall those who gave the full measure of devotion to our country's peace and security. Bring to mind the sacrifices of those who have served faithfully until death in the protection of our freedom and the defense of our land. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of hosts, uphold Kevin, Carla, Wayne, Kimberly, Katie, Howard, Craig, John, Jackie, Shirley, Janice, Arlene, Dawn, Kimberly, Cheryl, Richard, Betty, Mark, Roberta, and all who suffer in our midst by your truth, that since you are at their right hand, they cannot be shaken. Gladden their hearts, cause their tongues to rejoice, and make their flesh dwell in hope. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of hosts, you revealed yourself to us in Christ, that we may know you by faith and confess you before the world. Give us your Spirit, that all churches may confess truly and faithfully your word and live in harmony of doctrine and life, in anticipation of that day when we shall kneel together at your altar. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we poor sinners confess that in our flesh dwells no good thing. If we are left to ourselves, we will die in sin, since that which is born of flesh is flesh, and cannot see the kingdom of God. Grant us, we implore you, your grace and mercy, and for the sake of Jesus Christ, send your Holy Spirit into our hearts to regenerate us, that we may firmly believe the forgiveness of sins according to your promise in baptism, and daily increase in Christian love and good works, until at last we obtain eternal salvation. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
And let the blood flow.
Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you
Thank you.
give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Let us pray. We give thanks to Almighty God that you refresh us through his salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Close this morning with our hymn number 717.